journalist who spent 8 years researching sexual secrets. Lisa Taddeo crisscrossed America and immersed herself in the lives of three ordinary women to uncover their most intimate secrets and sexual longings. The result has been hailed as the deepest non-fiction portrait of female desire ever written. Suburban housewife Lena is in a loveless marriage and reconnects with an ex, while schoolgirl Maggie has an affair with her married teacher. And glamorous Sloan is in an open relationship with a husband who likes to watch her with other men. And Lisa Taddeo joins us now from New York. Lisa, it's great to see you.
Great to see you. Thank you for having me.
This is a pretty confronting book in parts. Why did you want to write it?
I had read Gay Talese's work that he'd wrote in 1980 called Thy Neighbor's Wife. And while I really admired its immersive deep dive, he had also spent about a decade researching his book about sexuality in America. He spent time in a swingers commune. He operated a happy ending massage parlor. And while I admired the immersive quality, I felt it was told from a very male perspective. And I wondered what a book about desire would look like told from a female one.
So the stories are really explicit. How did you get these women to share such intimate details of their lives? And did it shock you sometimes just how open they were?
Yes and no. What I said to everybody that I spoke to was that let's just talk. And if at any point you feel like you've spoken too much or you've told me something you want to retract, then you can do that at any point. So I felt like I was pretty non-judgmental and also very free with what I was willing to do at any point. And a lot of people did take me up on that. And after 6 months to a year of my living in their community, they would say, you know, I don't want you to write about this part anymore. And I did that for them.
Mm-hmm. Lena's a suburban housewife whose husband won't kiss her anymore. What was the reaction when she shared that?
When she first shared that in this discussion group, all the women in the room leaned into her. They wanted to take care of her. And then a few weeks later, she had reconnected with her old high school lover, Aiden, and she started to meet him at this place called The River, where they would have this really mind-blowing, intimate experiences. And after she was telling the group that those same stories, they they removed themselves from her and started telling me afterwards that they thought that she was a slut.
Well, wow. But, I mean, so all these experiences that you had, the discussions you had, were done with other women from the community, so everybody was hearing it?
To an extent, with Lena, I was interviewing other people in her community about her. I did that with most of them. With Maggie, I spoke to her friends. I spoke to people who had been close to the trial. Maggie is the young woman who allegedly had a relationship with her high school English teacher when she was underage. And then he went on to win, to be awarded North Dakota's Teacher of the Year.
Wow. Lisa, firstly, as a man, I just want to tell you that I'm not at all threatened by any of these findings, and anyone who says I am is a liar, and everything's just fine in my marriage. Do you think these stories are extraordinary? They're very intimate. They're also, I suppose, in many ways, almost cliché. They sound like a kind of really saucy Mills and Boone novel. Do you think, are these actually typical experiences, though? Is this the sort of thing that women are experiencing all across America, presumably in Australia too, but we just don't know it?
Well, I think that with Me Too and everything that's going on right now across the world, we are very much talking about what we don't want, but we are not really talking about what we do want. And I think a large reason for that is that we're afraid of being judged for what we want, for wanting the wrong man or wanting the wrong woman or wanting the wrong career or no child. And I think talking about what we do want is almost scarier these days. And in terms of are all women doing this or feeling this way, I think if you talk to anybody for longer than a month, if you move into their town and if you are non-judgmental with them and don't talk to them, to their friends, and tell their secrets to their friends, I think you'll get a lot of that, of really deep secrets.
And were the three women connected in any way? Do they know each other?
No, not at all.
So what was your What was your desire when writing this book? What sort of message did you want people to take away?
Well, when I started writing, the first person I found who stuck in the book was Lena, the housewife in Indiana. And I was telling, I had moved to Indiana from New York City rather recklessly. I didn't have a place to stay. I stayed in an extended stay motel for a couple of weeks until I found an apartment. And I was talking to a friend of mine back in New York who said, "What are you doing in Indiana? When did you move there?" And I started telling her about Lena's story and how Lena would drive to meet this man, this high school lover, 4 hours away, would find babysitters for her children at the drop of a hat, would do anything to see this man, even for just 30 minutes. And my friend said to me, "Wow, that's so pathetic." And when she said that, I realized that there was a problem. And I said to her, I had to remind her that just several months prior, she had done the same thing. The man she had done it with.
Why did she think it was pathetic? Why did she judge Lena so harshly? And why do you think all of these women in your book are judged so harshly?
I think that we have a great deal of shame and we have a great deal of fear. And I think we project that shame and fear onto one another, specifically when it comes to desire. I think that also if we are past the desire that we've had, if we are past those longing moments, if we, for example, are picking out paint swatches instead of thinking about a lost lover, and we hear our friends tell us about that old love that she wants to rekindle, then we're in a new position and a place to be able to look down on someone else because we don't want to remember that hidden part of ourselves.
Do you think these women wanted sex, or did they really want love?
I think everybody wants love and sex to an extent. I also think that everybody mostly just wants to be seen for who they are. And I think these three women wanted to be seen for who they are, the way that we all do. But part of the difference is that they were just very raw and honest with another human being, me, about that. And I think it's hard for people to be honest about what they truly want deep down.
And you've said before that it was Sloane's relationship, the open relationship where her husband liked to watch her having sex with other men, that was the happiest. Why is that? Mm-hmm.
Well, her husband told her every day that she is his fantasy, that he wants her above all else. And even though his tastes are a bit aberrant, it doesn't mean that they are wrong. And if she didn't want to do them, if she said, "I don't want to sleep with other people," he wouldn't leave her. He wouldn't get angry. He would just say, "Okay." And she was trying to figure out what she wanted. And that was a complexity that I think we find in all of our relationships. But because Sloane's is aberrant from the norm, we are able to judge it more harshly because it doesn't make sense to a lot of people. But that said, they have a marriage that is so, they're in tune with each other. And there's a complexity and there's questions just like in any other relationship. But because it's not the norm, we sort of tend to look at it a little bit more harshly.
Well, Lisa's book is called Three Women and it's available through bookstores and online. Lisa Taddeo, thank you very much for joining us. It's certainly a fascinating and complex conversation you're having there.
Thanks, Lisa.